tell me, you know, I've been catching up on this. What are some of the things that really shocked you about the year that we've just gone through, 2020? And I know you're hard to shock, but tell me some of the things that really got you.
Probably the biggest disappointment, obviously the overarching theme of the year has been the pandemic, clearly that. And of course, with that has come the wiping out of what was left of the Black middle class. A lot of us have not been paying attention to that, but the COVID, pandemic, plandemic, scamdemic, whatever you want to call it, has destroyed a lot of Black businesses, a lot of startups, a lot of medium-sized Black businesses, a lot of brothers and sisters who have been doing quite well for decades are now out of business. So this COVID has definitely set back the Black entrepreneur. And so that's one of the disappointments more than a shock. The other disappointment, I can't help but bring it up, and that is the way that we as a community mishandled the George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, and Breonna Taylor protests for justice that took place a few months ago. Those were the largest, most protracted, and internationally recognized protests since the 68 protests that happened as a result of Dr. King's assassination. And we got absolutely nothing out of it because we did not control the narrative. We did not keep the protests all Black, nor did we communicate exactly what our demands should have been. So we wasted a grand opportunity to really get something done for Black America.
Do you think that that could have been a good format for someone to step forward and say, these are our demands, this is where we want support, and should it be in the form of money, or what's your thought?
It absolutely should not be in the form of money. I did a two-part, well, for Kwanzaa, I offered my own seven-night Kwanzaa series live stream seminar. And on night 4 and 5, I did a two-part seminar on Black economics. And any of your listeners who wants to watch that, they can go to my Facebook page, which is Dr. Umar Ifatunde on Facebook, IFATUNDE. I have 412,000 likes on that page. Again, Dr. Umar Ifatunde, and they can watch both night seminars. And I gave Sister Ann what would be my particular reparations demand list. And on my list, money was not included. But what was on my list was control over all Black music, publishing rights, as well as royalties. If Black people could reclaim our control of our music, Sister Ann, which is arguably our greatest cultural contribution to American society, socially and economically, if we could just control the music, we would be able to rebuild Black America, because music is America's second largest export. Most people don't know this. America makes more money off of music, mostly Black music, selling it domestically and internationally more than almost anything else that it sells. So if we could just take control of the music, we could rebuild our community.
Did you see that Netflix special called Ma Rainey?
I didn't. I saw a part of it, starring, yes, I did. I saw a good portion. I didn't see it from start to finish. My mother was watching it, so I joined her. I saw probably the middle hour, so I missed the first 30 minutes to the last 30 minutes of it. But what I did see, which I think you're about to speak on, and something I spoke on my Facebook Kwanzaa seminar the other night, has been the continued exploitation of the Black artists. We have been exploited by everybody. We, in the early years, we were exploited by the mob. You know, in the current years, we're exploited by the music conglomerates. The Black entertainer has had a very difficult time, not only being able to retain creative direction over their career, but even just trying to benefit from their own talent.
Yeah, it was amazing, because it was, I actually didn't get to see it from start to finish, but there was a gentleman in there that sold his music for $5, and he was trying to get published, and they took that $5 from him and that sheet of music, told him it was nothing, and went on to make millions of dollars with the song called Jelly Roll. And it just showed Ma Rainey being so tough, and she was used because it really portrays her as being somebody unsympathetic. But then when you really think about it, she probably had to be.
Absolutely, she had to be. She absolutely had to be. You know, and we need control of the music, sister. And in addition to that, I said we also need to put together investigation teams around the country to investigate how much land was illegally stolen from Black people. As you know, from the end of slavery all the way through Reconstruction, coming up to the early years of the Civil Rights Movement, a lot of Black people were simply forced off their land, scared off their land, intimidated off their land, you know, and manipulated off their land. Tens of thousands of acres is what some estimates have with regard to what was taken from us unjustifiably. We need to get that land back. That should be part of the reparations package as well. And I also say that we should demand control, total control of the leading port in the 10 major states that account for 58% of the African American community in this country, which include places as Florida, Texas, Maryland, New York, New Jersey, North Carolina. There's 10 states that account for 58% of all Black people, and all of them are adjacent to water. They are all sea bordering states. Illinois is one, but of course, Illinois isn't a sea bordering state, but it is a lake bordering state. So if we could control the ports alone, we would be able to bring in billions of dollars in revenue just off imports and exports. So we need to get serious about the reparation situation. A lot of people who are here articulating the reparations have not been, in my opinion, sincere enough and visionary enough in what exactly it is Black people should be asking for. Bob Johnson, former owner of BET, put forth a reparations package earlier this year. I can't remember if you and I spoke about it on air, but he said that of the 42 million eligible American Africans, that we should each get approximately $350,000 apiece as compensation for slavery. And I said, that is absolutely ridiculous. What can you do with $350,000? That might be a house. It might be a house and a car. But if you're telling me a house and a car is adequate compensation for 400 years of dehumanization of forced labor and psychological trauma, you're absolutely out of your mind.
What do you think about the one that Claude Anderson came out, Dr. Claude Anderson, with the railroad train going through the southern region of the country?
I have to look a little bit deeper at that. I'm a big fan of Dr. Claude Anderson, so I have to look a little bit deeper, you know, at what he is requesting. But I don't see why his plan couldn't be merged with my plan, the plan of the National Coalition of Blacks for Reparations in America. That would be a third entity. You have a lot of different groups out there, but they need to be brought together. And not only do they need to be brought together domestically, Sister Ann, as a Pan-Africanist, I am in big favor of us bringing all of the reparations movements globally together under one umbrella. I think we do ourselves a disservice and we risk having the entire reparations movement manipulated and basically ignored if we don't, because Africa right now is fighting its own reparations. The UK is fighting its own reparations. The Caribbean, through the CARICOM, or the Caribbean Economic Community, they're fighting their own reparations. Central and South America, where there was also slavery, they're fighting their own reparations. We need to put all of them under one umbrella. There was one slavery that took Africans all over the world, and so there should be one reparations movement to compensate us as a race.
You know what? If you could get that accomplished, it would, or anybody, because for right now, what I see just as a person looking at stuff, it's like you got so many jealous people, you know, maybe jealous of you, or jealous of what you've been able to accomplish, or jealous of what somebody else is able to accomplish. And it looks like nobody can really, get it together, because it's people like you that we listen to and respect, because, you know, you're on the front line of this thing. You're on the front line. And it's like, if you can't get together with folks that are willing to put themselves out there like you, you know, you've been barraged with all kinds of stuff that normal people could not take. So it's like, it's almost demands that people that are standing up there in the forefront sort of get together with folks like you and trying to figure out how to lead the rest of the people. I know Neely Fuller talks about, you know, not getting folks like you all together because they're afraid that the enemy will just find you and destroy you like they're probably trying to do, and just create a code that we systematically abide by. Now, that's a little complicated, but what's your feelings on what I just said?
Well, I think you're absolutely right. As far as Neely Fuller, another elder who I have tremendous respect for, but I would probably disagree with him a little bit, only in that, you know, recommending that we not come together doesn't take us closer to our goal. So we understand we're going to go to jail. We're going to get killed. We're going to lose our jobs. We're going to have our reputations assassinated. But that's understandable, because if you look at what the white man has done and you look at his vulnerability biologically, economically, culturally, socially, and politically, you understand he's going to pull out all possible stops in order to stop the march of the African. Napoleon Bonaparte, who's considered European's greatest general, although he lost the Haitian Revolution to black generals, Toussaint Louverture and Jean-Jacques Dessalines. But when he was asked about the need to crush Haiti and stop the slave rebellion, and they asked him, you know, why was it so important to do this? And Napoleon said, we're not doing this just to put down the slave revolt in Haiti, which, of course, he was unsuccessful in trying to do. But he said that we're not doing this just to stop Haiti. We're doing this to stop the march of progress of African people in the world. And I think sometimes we fail to recognize that the entire rest of the world depends on black people staying disorganized and disenfranchised, because their success is contingent on our dysfunctionality. Every race in this world is where they are because we are where we are, which is disorganized, which is why multiculturalism is a joke. Black people who embrace multiculturalism have no thorough understanding of race and power at all, because if you did, you would understand how ridiculous it would be for a black person to push multiculturalism when every other culture is committed to your dysfunctionality in order for them to be empowered.
Well, I think that a lot of people think when you say multiculturalism, you're being racist. But it's not racist to love your own folks.
And everybody does that except us. Everybody is racially exclusive. You know, for all the racial accusations that they've thrown at different black leaders throughout history, nobody has ever asked the European Jewish community, why aren't black people allowed to join your congregations? Nobody ever asks the Chinese people, you know, why aren't black people allowed to open up businesses in Chinatown? They never ask these questions of other people, which underscores my point. Nobody minds if any other group is able to achieve economic independence, but they cannot allow black people to do it because so many of the other groups exploit us and depend on our black dollar for their own cultural power. Sister Ann, when I did my seminar, I was looking at some of our annual expenditures, and they actually blew my mind. We spend $761 million a year on frozen meat, black people. Mm-hmm. We spend $4 million a year on children's cologne. Black men spend $60 million a year on toiletries. Black women, cultural hair. This isn't even including the weaves and the perms and the blonde hair. Just for cultural hair products, black women are spending $54 million a year. So if you look at the type of money that we are hemorrhaging that is going to other races, if we were able to redirect some of that cash flow back into the black community, we would put a lot of other communities out of business. Nobody wants to see the black man and woman rise. Nobody.
You know, I think that black women right now, I know that if I have to walk into a Korean hair store for a product, I kind of would feel ashamed of myself at this point for what I'm pushing. And I think until we develop that kind of shame, it's going to continue. And until black men embrace us as having hair that is not going to look like, you know, a white girl's hair, that is that's something that you guys got to make us or women feel a little bit better about how they are. So that's a mindset.